Okay, so good morning, everyone. So I'm working on Zen on ARM project since about 1 year now. I will give a quick overview about what is Zen and how we work with the cloud. So Zen project is part of the Linux Foundation collaborative project since last year. We have multiple sub-projects such as the Hypervisor, which is the main goal of Zen project. Zen project API. So the goal of this project is to be able to use the cloud with the Zen Hypervisor. We are also product on Zen project such as Zen Server, which is a very popular base product of Zen. It was partially closed source until last year, and it was open source by Citrix. So why is the cloud? So before the cloud, one of the things for the IT was to provide a consistent service for the company. So if you want to increase the capacity, you had to plan at least 1 year before to say, I want to add new servers. I need to have this service to be up. If you want to do any change, it may be complicated because you have to shut down one service, maybe replace the hardware and restart the service. So when you want to do change, you have to first testing and then checking that everything will work at the first step. And if you want to do any change at that time, if you integrate the change on the service, it's not a change anymore. With the cloud has reinvented how works IT. The goal of the IT now is to be able to have consistent service and to follow what the company is doing. For instance, for e-shopping, like for Amazon or any kind of other services, what you want to do is to have a big capacity for Christmas sales, like Black Friday, and you may want less capacity during other period of the year. So what you do with the cloud is like you can say, I want this amount of VM, this amount of service for these periods. So you can scale what you want when you want, like few days before, maybe 1 month before. If you do any change, it's like very good because you want to improve your service. You want to cover what you need at that time. So if you don't do any change, it's like you don't have any value anymore with the cloud. So the layer of the cloud, the first layer is like your application. It will run on the top of an operating system like you do with that cloud. What we add after is a virtualization layer. So the first three layer is only one servers. If you want to manage multiple servers at the same time, you will add a cloud orchestrations. And my talk will be mainly on the virtualization layer. So what we need for the virtualization layer? The first thing is that it must be stable. It must be secure. You need to configure on a large scale so you don't have access anymore to the servers or you have 1,000 servers. You don't want to go on every server and say, I want to start this guest. You need to have something to do that automatically. It must take an orchestration, so it must take an API, command line, whatever you want to be able to manage multiple servers. And it must be multiple tenants, so you may have like the Amazon cloud running multiple guests from different companies at the same time. And the last thing for the virtualization is we don't want to be tied to one provider, to one concept. So we need to provide a way to say we let the cloud provider, anyone to decide what you want to do with the cloud. The first thing, so the stability. So as I said, Zen project is used by Amazon AWS. There is a new project started by Verizon to do a cloud based on Zen. And we have a lot of partners in the Linux Foundation to work with us, like Amazon, AMD, ARM, CA, Cisco, Citrix, Google, Intel, NetApp, Oracle, Rackspace, and so on. The second thing after the stability is the security. So what we provide SELinux. So this is part of in the guest. And the SELinux team also did Flask. So Flask is capabilities to say I want to at the VM level to say I want to access to this VM as is able to access to this device, is able to do manage other guests, etc. So it's user. So we also done disaggregation. What I mean by disaggregation is like instead of having everything in one guest, like every device, you can. I will talk about it a bit later. So you can have one device per VM. So the library device will be on the VM. So if you had to restart your network, you can also only restart the VM and not the world host. And that's also the architectural advantage of the TIP1 hypervisor. If you want to know a bit more about that, we have some slides on the website of Xen. The third thing is to be able to configure at large scale. So we provided a tool stack, which an API on command line tools. So anyone can add this cloud orchestration on top of this. So we have lot of orchestration like power tools such as Puppet, Chef, Xen servers, cloud layers such as OpenStack, CloudStack, OpenNebula, etc. So we are not tied to someone. We just let people decide what they want to do with Xen projects. So about the resource stack. So we have three default tool stacks. The default one is provided in Xen directly. So if you want to use Xen, we directly provided Excel. We have some support for libverts with Virsh. These two tool stacks only allow you to handle one server, so you can't do multiple servers at the same time. So we have also another project, Zappy, that I was talking a bit before, which allows you to manage multiple hosts at the same time. Some companies have made products on top of that. So Oracle has done Oracle VM, UI, did UVP and Citrix did the server. And this product may be used by different companies such as Amazon, Rackspace, Cloud Servers. The next thing for the virtualization for an hypervisor, what we ask is to be multi-tenant. So multi-people share the same resources. So this was required for the cloud. You share resources between company, between users. So that is done by Xappy. And this is what the host provider needs. There needs to be something that could be shared by everyone. And one of the last things is that we don't lock you on a specific cloud. So we don't force the view on the clouds in general. We don't say you need to use Amazon, you need to use OpenStack, you need to use anything else providers. We let you choose what you want to do. And this is why the cloud is done on the open source. It gives the power to the cloud, but it also lets the cloud organization to innovate on new things about cloud. And we don't impose you to do any effort about some business corporate business plans. So you don't have you can choose your business plan and then use Xen if you want in your business plan. So we have multiple orchestration services such as CloudStack, Zappy, OpenStack, OpenNebula, Xen Orchestra, etc. So what's the status of Xen project? Xen project has done the Linux Foundations last year. So we have divided the project in four teams. The first team is the hypervisor in general. The second team is Zappy. The third team is the ARM hypervisor. So it's for servers on mobile. And the last team is about the Mirage OS, which is a unikernel, which can run on a VM. For the governance, it's a mixture between Linux Foundation, Linux kernel, and Apache governance. So every decision is made by consensus. So if we want to do something, we talk together and we try to be agree on something to continue. We have also some sub-project lifecycle, so we can decide to integrate the sub-projects related to Xen project and then trying to push to improve them and pushing them on the community. And for every decision or for every management, we have We have a committee which decides as a team what should be done for them. Since the last few years, the number of people working on Zen has increased. So when in 2010, most of people were coming from Citrix and were working on Zen. And if you are looking on 2012, most people are coming from different companies. Companies are contributing to Zen if they want to add new features. So this is most of the thing is a company wants to add a feature, they usually come to us and say, I want to add this feature and I will work on it. So we help them to push their feature in Zen. Zen project started in 2003. It's quite old, but we had a lot of new features now. So we have unique kernel development such as Mirage OS. We have hardware support since last year, live migrations, high availability via Remus and Colo. And we support a lot of different guests as control domain or as guest domain. And we also offer different virtualization modes. And each different virtualization mode has disadvantage, and you can choose following the performance you want. What about the architecture of the hypervisor? There is two types of architecture on the hypervisor. The first thing is type one. It's a bare metal hypervisor. It's directly running on top of the hardware on the host guest which we're running on it. So everything is the hypervisor. So the device driver for the hardware. The device model is the emulation for the hardware emulation for the guest, the scheduler, the MMU, etc. It provides isolations between guests, reliability, on higher security because it's usually very small. The second tip, I think most of people know this is a type two, is host-hosted. So instead of running directly on the bare metal, it will run directly in the, on top of the OS. So the hypervisor will only use, emulate the device model. Everything else is on the host operating system. The main advantage of this is it's low cost. It has no additional driver, so you can use every driver from the host. And it's easy to use and to install. You don't have to modify everything to be able to start your type one hypervisor. Xen is not a type one, neither a type two. It's a type one with a twist. So, On the left side, there is a type one. On the right side is Xen product architecture. So we still have an hypervisor running on bare metal, running on top of the hardware. But we only use using MMU, so patch table support and scheduler. Everything else is on the control domain. So the control domain is the first domain which starts on Xen. We will use it like Linux on BSD. To use the device drivers, so we don't have to implement Xen in Xen. And for emulating the device for the guest, such as we use QEMU for emulating the device. What about Xen on Linux? Xen projects, the hypervisor is not in Linux, so you can't check out the Linux git on compiling Xen from it. You need to use a different git. But everything you need to run the hypervisor, such as the driver, is in Linux, or even the support of Xen. Many distributions have Xen supported directly by a package, so you can go to Ubuntu and apt-get install to a Fedora or Red Hat on you install, and you can directly install everything for your for Xen. The only thing is we don't have any support yet in RHEL 6. But we have a package, we have a specific distribution Xen for CentOS, which is running on CentOS 6. So, as I say, we have a control domain, which is a separate domain, on the guest domain. Everything is a domain in Xen. To be able to talk with the domain, to be able to access, so manage the guest, we have a console, PV console, which is giving you access to the DOM 0, and everything like tool management is running on user space in DOM 0. So if you want to start your your VM, you can start from DOM 0 on manage, migrate, etc. For more security, we have disaggregation. So disaggregation is trying to avoid using everything in the control domain. So on basic setup, device model, drivers, tool stack is running on the control domain. What we want to do is trying to disaggregate the control domain. So for instance, you want to have a device driver domain. So you can run your network on a, assign your network to a guest. And this guest will run everything about the drivers, about the network. You can run also device model on different domains for security. And you can try to move the tool stack on a different domain. So this is done mostly for isolations and mostly for trying to give less privilege to this domain. So you can also easily restart one part of the service without restarting everything. So in Xen, we provided many different virtualization modes. One of the first virtualization mode, which was created in at the start of Xen, was a PV, par virtualization mode. So the guest is aware that it's running on Xen. So you need to modify the guest for handling the MMU, the page table, the privilege instructions. So you can't take a guest on running on PV. You need to modify the guest. The second thing was I did was the HVM, hardware virtualization, virtual machine. So we use the CPU extension to be able to trap everything that was done by the guest. For instance, if you want to access to a device, we'll trap the device and emulate in QEMU. And we don't modify the guest. So for instance, you can run Windows as HVM, but you can't run Windows as PV because you don't have the code source of Windows. You can't modify it. This is also called the full virtualization, FV. And after that, so HVM and PV, both of them has the advantage, but all of them has also some disadvantage. So we try to add PV HVM. So it's HVM with PV drivers. So what is done is that the OS guest is not modified. What we had is drivers for the network, for the disk, which is paravirtual. So you don't need to, you don't have to emulate that. It's a bit faster. And we added recently, so this year, a new mode PVH. So it's a PV in HVM container. It's not the same thing as PV HVM. So it's a PV guest, but we serve, but we use hardware extension for the PV MMU. So instead of virtualize the MMU, you directly use the one provided by the processor. It should be the best mode of virtualization with hardware virtualization in the CPU for the next few years. So here it's a big summary about the different virtualization mode and what is good or not. So if you're looking is, the HVM is not the best solution because if you want to emulate disk on network, you have to, it's very slow. You have to trap in Xen, you have to emulate in QEMU, then going back to the guest. With PV driver, it's a bit better, but you still have the timer and center, which is emulated on everything about the boots. The PV HVM, we par virtualize the timer on the interrupts. And for PVH, so the new mode is, as I said, it's mostly the best thing because we use par virtualization for the disk interrupt on the boots, and we use virtualization hardware for the page table. So that's the main improvement from the PV mode. So as you can see, PV mode is using par virtualize for instruction page tables, but it's still a bit slow. So I was talking about disaggregation a bit earlier. Disaggregation is used on some projects such as CubeOS. CubeOS on Citrix Xen client is trying to do a secure operating system. So everything is running on a VM. what they're trying to do on Kubernetes is trying to run an application per VM, so every application is secure from everyone. So if the application is trying to mess up your file system, they will only mess up the file system of the guest. And there is some prototype for servers also to be able to disaggregate and for more scalability. So as I said, the benefit of disaggregation is security, flexibility, most availability, robustness. So if your network driver is crashing, you just have to restart the domain. So for instance, if you have an Ethernet driver in a domain is like less than a few hundred milliseconds to reboot the network drivers. And that's all. So we have also some security advantage. So I was talking about you don't have to use advanced security by default. Everything is already done in Zen. So you don't have to add new patch, new feature. So first thing is we have a part of Zen which is we consider as trust, like DOM 0 on the hypervisor. The most trusted is the hypervisor. It's very small, so you have less code, so should be less bugs. And it's nearly nothing is running in the hypervisor. So what we provide in the hypervisor is like creating a guest, accessing to the memory, asking to have more memory, giving permission to another guest to access your memory. If you want to have finer security, you can use XSM. So it's like LSM in Linux Security Module, but for Xen. And we use Flask, which has been created by the NSA. It's developed and maintained, and it's compatible with SELinux. So if you know how to do a SELinux policy, you will be able to do any policy for Xen. And what can provide Flask is granularity security. So you can say, can a guest talk to another guest? Can a guest can only communicate with the control domain, so DOM 0? Can a guest can have memory, which cannot be read by the control domain, so you can say, I don't want that the control domain accesses memory. What type of device model I will use? We can also say security role, so you can say pair domain, which will be the security role. And what the policy is written in contrast, so you say this domain has only access to that, so it's a whitelist policy. One of the new projects which was started 2 years ago is the ARM hypervisor. So we support ARM v7 and ARM v8 products, so we are able to run on multiple different platforms, actually on ARM v8, the Versal Express, which is platform made by ARM for testing the Arndell, the Chromebook, Cortex-A15 in general, or Winner, or MAPTI. So if you want to add a new platform, it's like you have only had to a few hundred lines of code to say, I want to start this device. It's not very difficult. And we have also ARM v8 support for FastModel, which is the ARM v8 model for ARM. On the IPM Exgen Mustang, which is the first server with ARM64-bit processors. And if you want to work on any board like CodeRoid, etc., you can directly to go to the wiki of Zen, and you have everything explaining how to start to use Zen ARM on your board. So one of the best things compared to x86 on Zen ARM is like the ARM architecture is very straightforward for the virtualization. So what they provide is a device way to describe. So it's a way to describe the hardware. And you have the device on one side. You have the general timer, the geek, which is the interrupt controller, and the MMU on the other side. And there is three level of, privilege level on the ARM side, from 0 to 2. So the level 0 is the user mode. There's a kernel mode. We use hyper. There is a way to talk with I prefer the mode, the EL2 via the instruction intercall interface, SVC. So Xen is directly running on EL2 and is using the general timer, the GigV2 on the MMU on any guest VM, including DOM0. So we don't have any difference between DOM0 and the guest. Everything is has the same mode. It's directly running on EL0 and EL1. So only DOM0 have access to the hardware, the device. And every other guest is using paravirtual driver to access to the disk, to the network, etc. So compared to x86, we have only one mode. So everything is virtualized except the PV drivers. So we don't have any code to add in, we don't have much code to add in the guest except the drivers. One of the best advantages of ARM compared to x86 is we don't have any legacy. So the ARM port is less than 17,000 lines of code compared to x86, which is about 100,000 lines of code. There is also a ARM port for non-virtualized processors such as ARM V5 to ARM V7, which has been made by Samsung, is not on the Xen upstream. It's called ARM Hypervisor for mobile devices. Another sub-project of Xen is Mirage OS. What is Mirage OS? It's a library operating system. So it provides you a way to run an application directly on top of in a Xen guest. So you don't have to run a full operating system with scheduler, MMU, etc. You will run only one application in Xen guest. Some examples are Erlang, which is directly using, you can directly use Erlang to program your applications. We have some other things also for Haskell, OCaml, on Java and C. One of the most benefits, like what I say, like, is small footprints, like you can start in less than 1 megabyte on running a full HTTP server in that. You have startup latency, so it's very, very fast to start. If you want to migrate your VM from one server to another server, it's very fast. So as I say, it's part of the Xen project incubator. The new release, there is a new release that was released in July, the V.2 with ARM support and more things. It's very light and small, like Docker, but with full security of the Xen Hypervisor projects. There is also clean implementation of TCP, new implementation of TCP, DNS, SSH, OpenFlow, HTTP, XMPP. Everything has been written in OCaml. What's next? The last release of Xen project was in April 2014, so a few months ago. It was Xen 4.4. So this release has new interesting things such as PVH, which was no very in the code. We have also some improvement on updates on libvirt. We also released at the same time Xen for CentOS, so you can download a CentOS ISO and be able to start directly start Xen on a guest, directly trying on live. We start with some experimental support on UEFI on nested virtualization. So for instance, you can run Xen on KVM in your guest. We had also, that was the first release where we officially support ARM. So before it was only experimental. We also support Spice, GlutterFS support. The next release, so we have a 6 months release. We try to have 6-9 months release. So the next release will be next December. I think every year that is one of the first release where there is a lot of new features. No release until this one has many features as this one. So what is done is like PVH mode performance. So PVH was quite new on Xen 4.4. So we try to improve the boot times, even the performance at runtime. We had some Mirage OS and Unikernel support in general. with lot of ARM support, lot of improvement performance, same for Libhirts, with Remus support. So Remus is like high availability support on Colo, which is still in development, on so on, so on. All the features will be released in next December. Even such that we are trying to release the new Nuxen in few months, we are trying to do new things as we join the Linux Foundation. One of the first things is, one of the big projects is to share the test infrastructure. So actually, every company that is working on Xen has this test infrastructure. So we don't have any common things to be able to say, oh, this patch is not working. We don't have all the hardware. So we're trying to together on one place every hardware. On this hardware, we'll be able to know if the patch is going to Xen or not. So our process is, we are pushing in the basic branch, in the stage branch, the patch. A bunch of tests is done. So if one test is not working, we are not pushing to master. So we're trying to not block the master for everyone. We're also trying to do more to work with distribution to have a better integration of Xen. So you may be able to start directly Xen without installing any package or just doing apt-get. We are trying also to focusing on clouds, such as ClusterStack on Xen Orchestra. A new project that was announced like a couple of weeks ago was Xen on Automotive. So some people are working on trying to push Xen in the cars, trying to make Xen being able to work with a real-time system on very small footprints, improving latency. Intel is also working on Xen GT, which is GPU pass-through, so you may be able to have multiple guests running game, running high-demanding graphic applications without any little downtime compared to prioritizations. And the last thing is libvirt and virt manager, better integrations. So if some people want to work on Xen, is we have different way to work on Xen. The first thing is we have document day every first Wednesday of the month, last Wednesday of the month. The document days, we are trying to improve the documentation of Xen. So on each document day, we are saying, so we need to improve this part of the documentation. So how to start Xen, how to build Xen, how to start a guest. So we are working every Okay. Okay. We are trying to improve everything about documentation. So if you're interested to work on Xen and you found that some part of the documentation may not be clear, we encourage you to improve that on the wiki. We have also have before release, so the how that works then is like we are 3 months after before the release, we have a feature freeze. So it was like a few days last Wednesday. So no new feature is adding then, so we are trying to stabilize the code. And after we think that the code is stabilized enough, we start to ship RC. And at every RC, we have test day. So test day is just people are trying on different configurations then, and we are trying to find if there is new bug. And if we find that at some point there is no new bugs or it seems to be stable or new big bugs, we say that is the release for Xen 4.5. If you have any question, we have different mailing lists for user parts and for developer sides. We have also some IRC where you can talk directly with the different developer asking why it's not working, how I can do that in Xen. And we have some newsletter also to keep you informed about what's going on Xen. If you want any, you can access directly to xenproject.org for subscribing to the newsletter, to the main list. It's completely free and you will be able to access everything about Xen and be aware of what's going on. We also 3 big events every year to speak with developers and users. We have an hackathon usually in spring. It should be next spring, where people is doing 2 days staying together and talking about new features. So what we usually do is we are deciding about what should be the talk. We are saying, so there will be this discussion on this room, and people are just going on the room and talking about that and saying that might be the best things to do. That might be the I will do that like that. So it's mostly talking between people. We are also developer summit. Developer summit is most talk. So we are trying to do, people are giving talk about new features, how it works, what should be, what do we want to do? It should be on next summer. And we also Zen user summit, which is just for you, mostly for user explaining how to use, Zen in your business. If you want to see any presentation, any slide about Zen, everything will be on the zenproject.org. And I think they plan also to put on the website of Kernel Recipes also the slide. Thank you for patience on your listening. Any questions?
So you have some good terms and connections right now.
Sorry?
Yeah,
I don't really follow this part, so I'm not sure what's going on Gloucester. If I remember, it was for the guest support. But I have no idea on this part. I would advise you to ask on the user mailing list about that. Yes. I think the code of the NSA is self-contained. It's mostly hook for securities like calling XSM. This code is not enabled by default. You can disable the code. By default, if you are accompanying them by default, you don't have XSM on flash enabled. You have to specifically say, I want to enable XSM to be able to use them. On I don't think there is other code written by the NSA on the other part of Xen. So it's pretty self-contained and it's not installed by default. As I said, the only part written by the NSA is not enabled by default, is not compiled by default. So if the record is like in one directory, which is not touched. And it's mostly, most of the code is like just asking for some callback. It's not like touching any, algorithm or something like that. It's only to say, can I access to this guest or not? I don't know if I answer to your question. We We usually try to review by multiple people every code that is done in Zen. I know that even reviewing a code, you may not see everything, but so far it has been used by a lot of companies, and I didn't see any worry about Xen on the NSA part of code. Most of the XSM, I don't think is the code written by the NSA. I don't think many companies using it. Maybe QoS on Xen40xia was I was talking before, but Cerberus is not using XSM, as far as I know. Yes. No, so even saying PVH for ARM is a bit misleading, because we invented a new guest virtualization mode for Xen. We don't have any DBS model for emulation, so we get a ride of QEMU, so get a ride of any pain to be able to use QEMU implemented in Xen, etc. Because it's slow, it's needed some lot of coding Xen. What we done is like we the guest is using PV drivers, network on drivers. We still use event channel to talk with a device driver, but the event channel is delivered by the interrupts. So we directly use, so ARM is providing a geek interrupt controller with virtualization. So we directly use the virtualization of the interrupt controller to be able to deliver anything to the guest. What has been added on ARM for the OS? I did a port of FreeBSD on Xen on ARM. It just like took me 2 weeks, because what you need to do is like plumbing a bit of device tree to be able to read how I'm running on Xen. I need to register the CPU to Xen. But on, you have also like adding new drivers, PV drivers, etc. You don't have to modify the code of the OS. You just, it's like you may need like less than 1,000 lines of code for plumbing for Xen on after your device your drivers. So it's very, very small. We are trying to not modifying the guest to be able to avoiding the same issue we had on x86, modifying a lot of code in Linux. I remember, I know that Linux didn't really like when we push Xen support on x86, so yes, it's very, very self-contained. We have, I think it's not experimental anymore. I don't remember if it was on Xen 4.4 or Xen 4.5, but no, it's completely different code. So we only share the common port via API call, etc., but ARM on x86 in different passcode. The API call is exactly the same. The Xen IBI is exactly the same between x86 and ARM. We didn't modify that, but some API call may be a bit different, and some of them may not be implemented on ARM or on x86. But yes, we are trying to share most of the code between x86 and ARM. It's less code to write, more easier to modify. And if you want to add a new architecture like PowerPC or I don't know which, maybe MIPS with virtualization, if there is any virtualization in MIPS. But yeah, you can reuse most of the code. I think yes, on the when I was saying about 10,000 line of code, it's take account of the common code of x86. So without that, it should be like maybe 3,000 line of code for ARM, a bit more, few hundred lines of assembly, and the other thing is easy, mostly. I think yes. I'm not working on x86, so I'm not really following what's going on 686, but if I remember, yes, we have support for SRIOE. I think we are done. We have a lot of people from Intel, ARM, and AMD. We have working on Zen in general. So we are trying to speak with them about how they might not fit to what we want. So we may like that. Or how can we use the new things in Zen, etc. I have no idea what has been done with C66. It had been done like 10 years ago, so. But I know that in ARM we are trying to speak with the ARM people to improve the, as ARM is very new on server, so we are trying to get involved on the ARM ecosystem to give our voice about what should be done and what we, if it may not fit, like we are working on XCPI, if it may not fit with Zen, what we would want to do and what we would need to be able to work with in Zen. So yeah, we are working with every vendor company, processor company to try to fit their business on trying to have something simple in Zen. Any other questions? Thank you.